Morning, beloved. Welcome all the newcomers. Welcome on Zoom. If you're catching us online, write to us. Our handle on Facebook is at Beloved Sons of God. And so if you write to us, if you live in Bombay, you know, and then we'll tell you where we gather and you can come and be part of other sons among us. Also, if you're joining us internationally, anywhere, there's a link below this video. And if you click on it, it's going to open up to all the scripture verses and PDF file. So welcome. Okay. So today I'm sharing on the Living Kingdom. Our services are going late, but I'm happy because there are more testimonies, okay? So whenever I start, please know that it's going to be an hour from there, okay? And the word is most important, and the reason why you're having all these testimonies is because you're honoring the word. And so even as you're hearing that word, see how that word is playing out in your lives. We haven't recorded those testimonies, but a quick share, you know. Many people came here and shared about healings that happened, and this is healing that is happening not by someone laying hands on you, but just by awakening to who you are, and that resurrection life in you is doing what it's already put there to do, and it's repelling. Okay, so we had a testimony of someone who had a corn on the foot, and how she just knew that she's dead. And so how can you know, sickness be on a dead person? Have you ever seen cancer be on a dead person? It won't survive, right? And the Bible says that you died, the body is dead. Okay, but the spirit is life because of the resurrection life in you. And that resurrection life is repelling all of the sickness. So even as they rested and just reminded of who they are, that resurrection life began to work and flow out by agreement. Because they're just remembering that they're sons, they're relaxing, they're resting. And so that resurrection life is already repelling that corn. Someone else shared a testimony of something in the nose, or you know, something was happening, some infections in the body, and how she again remembered that resurrection life is in her, and it will automatically do what it's supposed to do. So how are these things happening in the lives of sons? Just by not forgetting. I told you, only responsibility is don't forget. In that moment when something comes to knock your door and say, hey, you're sick, or it's trying to bring you an identity, that's the time when you remember that, hey, I'm a son. It's not in my nature that resurrection life is there. And that resurrection life pushes out, and this entire thing, whatever was in her nose, just comes out. Okay? And this is what sonship is. It's playing out for you even by you just not forgetting who you are. Okay? So, you know, there's another testimony that Hinal shared, okay, of how she wanted something. And this lovely dress that she saw online, and that is a bit miraculous, because things online don't just show up in a shop that you're just passing by, unless it's a big brand, okay? So she's going by and she sees something that she wants to wear for a birthday, and she desires it, and it's going to be delivered really after the birthday. And she gets into a rickshaw, and the rickshaw guy takes another route, and she sees the same dress hanging, and that person goes and even makes it for her in the color that she wants. I remember something similar happened when I'd come into the kingdom many years ago, and I'd come to India at that point, you know, and I'd gone to this exhibition, and I had come to India, and there was no job as yet. And I went for an exhibition, and I loved these two dresses, and they were really expensive. Like, I think at that time, they were like some 4,000 or 5,000 rupees each, okay? And I really wanted it, and imagine I have no job. And I liked it. And I just told the father, I said, I love these two dresses, but I can't have them, but I really love them. And then the next day, I get a call in the morning. I had some scarves lying at home, okay? And someone wanted some scarves from me. And the value of one scarf was 8,000, okay? And so he didn't take one, he took two. And suddenly the next day I had money, and that exhibition was still there. Like, it was there for another 2 days, and I could go and buy those two dresses. And you'll see in these small things that the Father is so real, that you desire it, and he says, just desire it, it's there. It's not you who wanted it, it's the Father wanted you to have them. Okay, that's why he put that desire in it, and the Father is so good. Okay, so we've been talking about the Living Kingdom. Okay, and I spoke about last week, I'm going to put this board up by my one hand because I have the spirit of might. Can everyone see it? For the Zoom people, if you can't, I put a photo of that on the Oneness group so you can see it. So for those who weren't here, okay, nothing in the kingdom of God is a concept. So if you talk about faith, faith is a living being. If you talk about wisdom, wisdom is a living being. So we talked about the seven spirits last week, right? We spoke about the spirit of rest. We spoke about the spirit of wisdom. We spoke about knowledge, the spirit of understanding. We spoke about the spirit of might, the spirit of counsel, and the spirit of the fear of the Lord. Okay, here the earlier video, which I put up on YouTube. We have a YouTube channel. And so if you go to Beloved Church on YouTube, you're going to find all those videos. So you can engage and have a relationship with all of these. Jesus had a relationship with all of these is because they're meant to serve you. They're there for a reason. It says that wisdom was with God and he created wisdom. And then wisdom was the one doing all of these things right from the creation, even before anything was laid, before the foundations. And through wisdom, God did all of these things. Okay. And in Proverbs, it talks about wisdom as being a real being. And so you can engage with wisdom. So one of the things I never knew I had was the power of, was the spirit of might. And I don't think the body of Christ has tapped into this, right? And I gave you the example of Samson in the Old Testament, right? And Samson, he had this power and he took all the pillars down and everything. So remember last week I shared about engaging with the spirit of might in the gym? And there was this huge tire, about like 80 kgs. Now you have to know that when I go to my gym, I even take my own weights. Like I have a problem with 2 kgs. So I'll be like, you know, he's like, we don't even do anything below 2 kgs in our gym. I went and bought my own weights of 1.5 kg, okay? And so they laugh at me when I go to gym, like, oh, there she comes. Like, you know, she even brings her own weights and comes, okay? Like, why does she come to our gym? So, and now this is a tire that was there on the terrace, right? And this tire was 80 kgs. And so I told you last week, when I went there, 80 or about 100, I don't know, but about 80, okay? And so he told me, he's like, you know, I said, how heavy is this tire? So he's like, it's about 80 kgs or whatever, double your weight. So I went and how much could I lift it last week? I could lift it like a few inches above, okay? And I told you, I called on the spirit of might. I remembered that I'm not going to lift this up, the spirit of might will. And so I could lift it up and I could like barely get it off like a few inches off the ground. But do you know when I lifted it up a few inches off the ground, I rejoiced. And I actually shared last Sunday that I rejoiced because I lifted it up a few inches off the ground, okay? So now I go back to gym the next week. And I get a call while I'm at gym from 4 sons from Beloved, or 5 sons, okay? Right when I was at gym and I get a video call. I believe that video call was just to remind me, okay? And so I get this video call and we're just saying hi, hello. They didn't know I was in the gym. And so then one of the sons goes like, Priya, so remember, huh, spirit of might, okay? And then she tells me, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. But do you know that in the old, when that is quoted, that verse, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord, it's meaning it's not in your might, not in your power, but by his power and his spirit. So when she said that, I was like, okay, I have the spirit of might. So again, now this time I go to the, so I want to share this because I want to tell you, everything that you hear, go and apply it. Because if you don't apply it, how will you even know that it's real? Okay. So I went to the terrace part of this, and then suddenly on that particular day, now I've been in this gym for over a year. I've never had someone flipping tires in front of me, okay, doing that, at least at the time when I'm there. This particular Sunday, I had this huge guy. Now this guy's buff, okay, like he's really built up, and he's taken this huge tire, and he's just flinging it, okay, and he's not just flinging it, he's exerting some sort of pressure and flipping it, and exerting pressure and flipping it, and then this girl comes, now whether it was his girlfriend or his friend or his sister, comes and is taking a video to see how amazing this is, okay? And this guy is like a huge built-up guy. And so they're doing this in front of me and I'm looking at him flipping that tire, that same tire, okay? So now I tell my gym guy and everyone is like clapping at him and they're saying like, wow, he's so good and, you know, through training and everything he gets there. So now I tell my trainer, I said, I'm going to do this. So he's like, ma'am, last week, aapne maloom hai na, 1 inch thoda uthaya tha. He's saying, isme training lagta hai, let it be. Like, don't bother. Because just last week, we know what happened. Like, you couldn't even get it up. Okay? So, I'm like, so I tell him, I said, no, I'm going to do this. Okay? So, now, listen. Okay? So, everyone, so I went to this and I told my trainer, I said, please record it. Now, this is the faith that he had in me because he'd already seen 1 week before that I could barely get it like an inch off the ground. Okay? So, I go to this tire. He said, ma'am. I said, which was the tire? Because there were like 3 tires there. So he's like, it's this one, the 80 kgs. Now he told me, he's saying, why don't you start on the smaller one? Okay, like which is like about 30 kgs or 40. You start with that. I said, no, which was the one I couldn't lift? He's saying, yeah, lekin ab karo mat, isme training lagta hai. Wo jo aadmi kar raha hai means don't compare yourself to that other guy. He's done it for some time and so it takes, he's got, you know, used to that. So I said, no, I'm going to go. So now I go to lift my tire up, okay? Guys, and this is what I did. I said, spirit of might come. Because I'm not going to lift it. Spirit of might will. Okay? So I lift it and it goes right on top, and my trainer, and I was so irritated with my trainer because he's there. He ran to this guy with a hammer. He was hammering the tire because he didn't even believe that I would do it. And so the minute he saw me do it, he runs to get his camera to record it. And guys, I just didn't flip it once. I flipped it four times. You want to see the video? Okay, see this video. Okay. Hello, can you minimize this? Yeah, make it big. And guys, can you record? And make it just scroll it down. Okay, now this is a heavy tire, okay? That is a smaller one behind this, which you wanted me to carry. Okay, just play that. This is 80 kgs. This is no joke. So, and now you have to know how miraculous this is, because there's a guy hammering behind, and he stops hammering. Okay. Look how easy that is, which I couldn't even lift up an inch. And that guy stops hammering there because he can't believe I'm doing this. So listen, now the funny thing, after this what happened, I told you there was a guy, right? And this girl was recording him. Listen, this guy's face just fell because this puny little girl came and just started doing this. Because just a few minutes before, they were all clapping to this guy, like how difficult it is. And he's like, yeah, I'm building up. And, you know, he's like doing this. And then I was like, I'm going to do the same thing. And this guy just wasn't looking at me. The whole terrorist stopped. They started clapping, okay? So my trainer goes like, how did this happen? I said, I call, you know, Jesus, and I call on the spirit of might. He's saying, so all this time, why haven't you called him? Okay? Like, what have you been doing? But you, now, so imagine, okay? Now, I didn't do this. Like, this is the spirit of might who did this. Now, I go in the evening. Now, I've just lifted up 80 kgs. Imagine I have a problem with 2 kgs. And I've just lifted up 80 kgs here, okay? But because something broke loose in me, right? Like, I came to know that I have the spirit of might. I never engaged with him for all of these years. But the first time I decided to have a relationship with him, okay? And so the tire was the same. But what changed? How did the tire begin to respond to me? After I woke up. And that's how those situations will start responding to you. You think you need to pray for the tire. The tire doesn't need any prayer. Even as you start waking up as a son of who you are, you'll realize how all those, your circumstances, everything is responding to who you are. You are understanding, it's like a principle I'm showing you. Now I go home to sleep that night because now I have these things of like I've lifted up something heavy. I might get hemorrhoids, I might get a back pain, I might get things because I've lifted up like 80 or 100 kgs, I don't know how much. And I just didn't lift it once, I flipped it. Guys, I couldn't do it 1 inch before, okay? And I rejoiced on a Sunday and I celebrated it. And what happened, it multiplied. Okay, it multiplied because we don't have a poverty mindset. That's how even money multiplies. That's how even Jesus, the loaves multiplied, because there's no lack. And how did in 1 inch, I celebrated that I lifted 1 inch. I flipped it four times. That a very strong guy needs to rethink what his weights are now and how much he needs to lift before, okay, later on. And so I go in the night. Now in the night, I had this, when I'm sleeping, I had a glass of wine. I go to sleep in the night. And about like 3 or 4, I have pain come on me. Like pain come on me, okay? And now, do you know when you had those where you get up in the morning and you know you've had a conversation and it's so alive but you don't? And I was like in deep sleep, I don't remember this. But I felt pain come on me, on my shoulder and everything. And then I'm speaking this and I said, how can pain come on me when I didn't lift it? It was you who lifted it. See, did you lift it or did the spirit of might lift it? And so this is what I said, and I knew that I couldn't have said these things in my own wisdom. It was given to me at that time in the night. And so I got up, and I felt like pain, and then suddenly pain lift off, and no pain. And in my mind, I was saying, wow, that was so miraculous. That was so instantaneous, okay? And it was literally like a pressure came and a pressure left. A lie came or a shadow came and a lie left, because at that point, I addressed it. That's how sickness comes. That's how even cancer and all of these things can submit to if you don't forget who you are. So I got up in the morning and I remember this wake thing that happened in the night because I felt tingling all over my body. And then I remember telling the Holy Spirit in the night, I said, resurrection power, Holy Spirit, you take care of this. This is your job, not mine. I remember having this conversation, okay? And you do. And I felt like resurrection power, like electricity going out, like repelling, okay, out of me. It was like a little bit like a miraculous thing. So I got up in the morning and I remember having this conversation, like, because I was in so much sleep. And I realized what the words that I spoke was what truth. How can pain come on me When I didn't lift it, you did. So why should I be bearing the pain? How can pain come, right? It was a lie. And so literally the pain came, and in a minute, no pain. Everything got lifted off. Like, you think like pain, right? I've never had something this like miraculous, okay? But it was like this weight, and suddenly no weight, and everything left. And it was like because I addressed a lie that tried to come and tell me, hey, you did it. And I'm like, I didn't, Christ did. So by what authority? It's the same thing that Gitu. I'm dead, so how can the scorn exist here? Okay? Everything gets pushed out. Resurrection life in you is real. And if you don't forget, if you start speaking who you are, then all of the kingdom is bearing witness to the Son. Okay? Now I'm engaging with the spirit of might. You just saw it. I did it, and just because of a setback of 1 inch, I went again for it. And I believe the Father planted that guy there to flip tires for me to see it. That this guy is flipping tires. He's not even a son. How much more the Son? But I imagine this guy has trained for maybe 1 year, and someone is taking videos. That means it's really hard. And then this chick comes. My trainer had no faith, no video, and then runs to get his video, and he's aghast, and everyone stops on the terrace. Like, how did she do it? I said, the spirit of might did it. That's what I mean, right? Like in the old, you see Moses, right? He drops a stick and it turns into a snake. If that happened today, everyone would call it the occult. But whose idea was to turn the stick into a snake? It was God's idea. And so everything, the devil is not creative, he only copies. So the kingdom has it first, and then the world copies it. But because we don't see the miraculous, we call that, oh, that comes from the devil. No, the kingdom has a lot of power. And you can do those things. And so I believe, like, you know, that was such an amazing thing. I was flipping tires. When I saw that video, I only couldn't believe it. I was like, I had an issue with 1 inch. How did I begin to flip that? It's because when I was lifting, I said, spirit of mind, it's you doing it. It's not me. It is you. It is you. And then suddenly, as I realized it is him, I began to flip it and flip it. And such that, and in the night, no pain. Because I didn't lift it. He did. Okay, that's how real the kingdom is. And it will start responding to you, and your environment and your boss and everyone will start responding. And it looked rigid, right? Like it's not going up. Now think about your boss, not responding, not responding. My family member, not responding. But then you are changing and you're waking up, and now that same family member starts responding to you. Those things starts responding to the Son. That's how it changes, right? Hear the sermon on the solution to everything is Christ in you. Okay, it's you. That means, so all I tell, I know your problems are outside and looks like you need to pray for those problems. We don't. As a son, we just wake up to who we are. And then the problems shift to us. Okay, so let's go into the kingdom. So I want to just share on the spirit of might. So engage. You want wisdom, you want counsel. Don't pick up the phone and call me, Priya, what should I do? Go to counsel. Counsel, I thank you, you're with me. Tell me, counsel, now what am I supposed to do in this situation? And then counsel will tell you what you're supposed to do. And his counsel will be very different from maybe the counsel you get from the person next to you. Okay, engage, because the kingdom is so real. Okay, so now let's go to the, so we spoke about the seven spirits, okay? the seven spirits. So now we're going to go into the gifts of the spirit. What are the gifts of the spirit? When you become a son, you become a son into the kingdom. So let's read Ephesians 4:11, okay? Now look at this. It says here, and he gave some to be apostles. Apostle. What is an apostle? Someone who's starting a church. Apostolic. Okay. Some prophets. That means prophets. They're prophesying. We'll talk about all this. Some evangelists who are bringing people into the kingdom. Some pastors and teachers. Now see this. For the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So that they're all getting built up. Okay. Now what does it say in verse 13? Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That means, now this is called the fivefold ministry. Like if you go to most churches, there will be like maybe one guy has an anointing, you know, and he's into the prophetic and he's just prophesying. Someone has got like healings going on and he's just like healing, okay? And it's called fivefold ministry. And what is all of this for? What are all of these offices for? For one purpose, see this. So that you all come to the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That means, if you come here, do you need them now? That's why in Beloved, there are gifts. As a son, you'll engage in them. But we don't go after a gift. Because as a son, you'll operate in all of these gifts. Okay? Now see this, and verse 14, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men, in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, for from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Okay, so now all of these, we're going to go ahead. For newcomers, just hear the word and it's all just going to come together. I love Hina's life, I love Jigar's, you know, all of these new sons who are coming in, is because you're honoring the word, and through relationship, all that, it'll just increase, and you'll just come to know, okay? Now, all of these gifts are there for one purpose, so that you're coming to the maturity of the son. You're coming to the maturity of the son. That means at one point they will cease, okay? They're there to build you up. That's why I am in the role of a pastor, but you'll never hear me call myself a pastor. I mean, I know that if I have to go somewhere else, I'll say that, yeah, I lead the church and I pastor the church. But I always want to be in the identity of the son. And pastoring is one of the things that I do. And I lead a church, okay? And I always say that I'm a son who's leading beloved. Okay? I like to be in that identity. So look at this. Now, 1 Corinthians 13. I'm going to read something. Okay? Flow with me here. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles, carried away to these dumb idols, however you were led. Therefore, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. There are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. Diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. That means it's the Holy Spirit that's doing all of these things. Okay, now see this. It says here, there are differences of ministries, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of activities, but it is the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. For to one is given, now see this, one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. To another the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit. Now these are gifts of the Spirit. What is a gift? Do you have to do anything for a gift? That means it's independent of you. A gift. That's why people sometimes, look at, oh, but Priya, this person has the gift of healing, but look at the way this person leads their life. It's got nothing to do with what you do. It's a gift. That means it's a gift, meaning, do you know when you gift somebody a gift, it's got nothing to do with the person. They didn't earn it. It's a gift given. That means they can have the gift. Their doctrine can be completely off, but they can still operate in a gift because it is a gift given. Okay, look at this. The gift of healing by the same Spirit. To another, working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, different kinds of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as he wills. So there are 9 gifts of the Spirit that I'm going to talk about today. Okay, so there is the gift of wisdom, the gift of the word of knowledge, the gift of faith, the gift of healing, the gift of working of miracles, the gift of prophecy, the gift of discerning of spirits, then tongues, different kinds of tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Okay, now why are all of these there? Why are all these gifts in the body? So that at one point someone is speaking that and someone is doing that, so that you're waking up to this, to who you are, to the matured son. Okay, so all of these have one purpose, so that you get built up to the maturity of Christ, okay, as a son of who you are. So let's look at the first one, the gift of wisdom. So what is the gift of wisdom? I'm just going to read down what I put there, okay? The gift of the word of wisdom is the special ability that God gives to members of the body of Christ to receive instant insight on how a given revelation may best be applied to a specific situation or need arising in the body of Christ, or how a given situation or need is to be restored or helped or healed. Okay, now the perfect way, the word of wisdom or the gift of wisdom. Okay, for example, let's share the testimony that came in today with Sheetal's mom. She shared about, now she has never taken a loan to get a car. Now, sometimes I feel like people don't take credit cards and things. I believe that there's wisdom in that. And if you learn how to navigate that around that and don't become a slave, they can actually benefit you. So now she has a stronghold in the head, like no loan. Someone has put that there. Okay. And now suddenly someone opens up that, hey, it's okay to take the loan. and this car loan, and it's going to become easier. And then she realizes, just as wisdom opened up to her, that she could get it, she could even pay off that loan or whatever it is, get this car through ease in just a matter of few weeks. That something maybe that she was, someone has told her, no, don't go for loans, and she couldn't. But there is wisdom in that, right? Like I always, even if I'm planning to do a loan or anything, and my mom knows that, I never want it to be like a pressure. I want to see the parameters, I want to see what it is, whether I can pay it off with ease, with my lifestyle, with everything. And so I'm working in that. And then wisdom helps me. So it's the gift of wisdom. Where do you see it in the Bible? Let's read that, okay? In 1 Kings 3:16, 28. Okay, now this is, Kings is about Solomon, okay? And Solomon was known, God appears to Solomon in a dream and says, like, ask me whatever you want. And Solomon tells him, you know what, just give me wisdom on how to lead this nation. I want to know how to lead my people. And because it says that Solomon asked for wisdom and not for riches and anything else and for long life, God appears to him and says, you know what, because you asked for wisdom how to lead my people, I'm going to give you long life, I'm going to make you rich, I'm going to give you wealth, I'm going to give you everything. Okay, and to date it's recorded that Solomon was the richest king that ever lived. Okay, through wisdom. And in the Bible it says, through wisdom come riches and honor. So he was wise, he asked for wisdom. And through that came riches and honor. Okay, and so in Solomon's time, there was a situation that came. One of the people came, this lady came and said, you know what? Two people came and said that this son belongs to me. And so now Solomon as a king, and he has to discern, who does the son belong to? Whether it belongs to Lady A or Lady B. And so what Solomon gets this wisdom and says, you know what, let's cut the son in half. And so you can take one half and then the other one will take the other half. And then suddenly, do you know that true mother will not want the son because she doesn't want her son to be cut. So she's like, you know what, she comes before Solomon and says, no, let it be, let her have the son. And then he says that she is the rightful owner of the son. The son belongs to her. Okay, wisdom was given to him. Okay, like in Genesis, you see in Pharaoh, okay, Pharaoh has this dream. This is about Joseph's life, Genesis 41. Pharaoh has this dream and then no one could interpret this dream. Okay, it's about a famine coming over that land. And so Joseph goes ahead and says, you know what, all interpretations of the dream belong to the Lord. And so Joseph interprets this dream that, you know what, this dream means that seven years of famine are going to come. But it just didn't leave there. He just didn't interpret that dream. He got wisdom of what to do for Egypt also during that time. And so he said, now when these 7 years of glory time are coming, you know what, save all the grain. And when the 7 years of famine come, you're going to sell all the grain that these 7 years we've laid and stored up. And in that, he made Pharaoh the richest guy. Because in famine, they started selling the grain and people started giving their land, people started giving their animals and cows and everything, and he made Pharaoh rich. Wisdom, the gift of wisdom. Okay? And so you can engage with wisdom and say, you know what, in this situation, wisdom, what should I do? Sometimes wisdom is telling you, just wait. And just wait it out. I remember when, when many years ago I had this job, okay? And I told you I was doing this big company. This is a very big company in India. And they decided to work with me. And I'm just, my ship is like a one-man ship. Like I'm the only member on it. And then I might just hire like some other assistants who don't know what to do also, okay? And I'm pretty much teaching them. And so I was in interiors. I was in visual merchandising. And this huge company came and decided to do business with me. Now, it started off amazing and I started making wealth that I had not even seen. Okay, and I was like, wow, this is just doubling and tripling up. And then suddenly they decided, Priya, we want to work more with you. And now not just one project, we're going to give you, you're going to be doing a project literally every month with us. And so that suddenly became like, I was getting very busy, very, very busy. And then suddenly something in me said like, no, I don't want to do the smaller projects, because now it went into budgets and, you know, get the money down and more. So there was money, there was a lot of work, but like the money is coming down a bit, but still it's good money. Okay. So I decided now I don't want to do it. Now, trust me, the wisdom that came from the world, if I spoke to any friend, they were like, are you crazy? This is a big company that is coming to you. This looks like God. I said, but God will not make me very busy. It will be easy money. Like I understand in working hard. Like I know that, when I work, I want to put my best in it. So I understand that. And then the fruit of that will just keep on yielding many years later. Okay. But this was me just getting too busy and not having the time for anything. So I was like, no, I'm going to write a mail. So I wrote a mail and I said, because, you know, if it's a big company, they're going to contract you in it. And they're going to make you sign in it before you do something. So I decided not to. I said, no, I don't want. I wrote a letter. I said, I'll only do the big projects. The smaller ones, I don't want to do. And so they decided to go with somebody else, okay? praise God for that wisdom because I didn't get it from the world. I just said no because I just knew my father that if God gives me something, it will have the money, but it'll also be easy. It's not going to be like this sweat because I won't have time for the word. I won't have time for him. What's the use of the money? Okay. And so I did that. I said a no. Thank God I didn't sign anything because a month later, I got a show. I got back into TV because I had taken a long break from TV, getting back into TV. And then this big show came. And you know what I'm doing now? I'm designing and back to designing. And it just happened. And the same amount of money that I've made in a year, I'm making in a few months. Okay, God's wisdom. And I have even more time. And more things came out of that. But that wisdom could have only been given by the spirit of wisdom. Like Priya say noted, it looks good to the world, but not for you. Are you understanding? And so ask for the spirit of wisdom in all things. Okay, I remember, advice for married people. I've seen people do blunders and things just go down is because they didn't use wisdom. If you have children with you and if you're running a family, I've seen this happen because I'm just saying that. At that time, I was like, someone came and, you know, they had a family, they had children, and they both wanted to get into business. Okay, and they're like, we're trusting God with it. And in my mind, I knew that that's not a right move. Because if you have, it's another thing if I'm independent, okay, but if you're taking care of children, and I just said, I think one of you should be employed. And then the other one try out the thing of getting into. Now, this was not something that, like, you know, I got like a light and coming and thus you shall do it. It's just simple wisdom because it'll just help you make decisions because under pressure, sometimes you make foolish decisions with monetary pressures, okay? So I said that I don't think this is a good idea. One of y'all should be employed and the other one try out a new venture. They both didn't do that. They both went into, you know, by faith into this whole thing and it toppled down in some really bad things that have followed later on. But it began with something this simple. And it went into just bad choices, okay, for their family. And there was a strain on the marriage as well. And things like that happened. But it just came by just somebody not listening to wisdom or just asking for wisdom, okay? So get into wisdom. Ask for wisdom, especially in relationships also, okay? Sometimes it's just a matter of wisdom, of how are you speaking with people. Okay, let's talk about the gift of the word of knowledge. So what is the word of knowledge? Okay, the gift of the word of knowledge is the supernatural revelation from God that gives you details or information about a certain situation or person that is not known to you prior to the revelation. Okay, now we had a boy who came in, beloved. You know that, for some of you know that, who came in 2 years ago. And he had, I believe that he flowed more in the word of knowledge than prophecy. Okay, word of knowledge is where God brings something to your awareness about that person's life and you have no way of knowing it before. Word of knowledge is the way when I met Geetu, I told you she was, I had gone through a friend, she's a dermatologist and I'd gone to her clinic and then I get a dream about her life and I saw certain things and so I told my friend is like, no, this is not Geetu's life. I know her very well, this is not Geetu's life. And God caused it one day that suddenly I was alone with Geetu and my friend got a call and she had to leave. And so I was alone with her and I said, Geetu, I had a dream about you and so I saw these things. Is this your life? And she tells me who the person is and everything. And she's like, yeah, who told you this? I said, the father did because he loves you so much. And through the word of knowledge, she came into the kingdom. So why do you have the word of knowledge? It's to draw the sons in. So all of these gifts are there to equip you to help the son so that you're just bringing them in. Okay, let's look at Jesus, okay, in the Bible where we see this. Acts 9, 11 and 16. The Lord gave Ananias a word of knowledge by giving distinct information how to find Paul. Now, Paul is a guy, imagine he was like killing everybody in the church. And then suddenly he has this encounter with Jesus. And now his life is changed. Okay? And he's waiting, he sees this big light and so now he goes blind. And so he's sitting in a room and now God appears to Ananias. He's a disciple, he's already a son somewhere else. And then this is what is told to Ananias in Acts 9 verse 11. So the Lord said to Ananias, arise and go to the secret, to the street called Straight, and inquire at the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he is praying, and in a vision he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him so that he might receive his sight. So what is told to Ananias? Ananias is told the street name, where to go and what to do. So detailed is given to Ananias. Okay, so specific. And what happens? Paul also gets a vision there that, oh, this guy is coming, laying hands on me and I can see. So all of you can operate in the word of knowledge. the gift of knowledge. All of these gifts are one with the Son. And at a specific time, I'm telling you, you will flow in them. You will flow in them. Even as you know that they are there, you will just flow in them. I didn't know I was operating in the gift of knowledge till I read it. But it happened and I saw something for a life and I just said, hey, Geetu, is this true? I remember once I was in another church and I had a vision early morning. I saw an envelope come. Just an envelope giving with the person's name on it. Like, I've never heard this name. And there were two names written on this, the name and the surname. And then the envelope opens up, there's a little letter inside, and I'm supposed to go and tell her this. So I go to this church and I said, is there somebody by this name? So they're like, yeah, weren't you here last Sunday? Her husband is in the hospital. So I said, oh, I have a word for you. So I went and told her, I said, you know what? Jesus is the one who heals. He's a healing God. So your husband, God is there with him. Go lay hands on him. You know what I was telling her? I was just showing her the word. But sometimes when you hear the word out of a person's mouth, it becomes more alive to you. And that's why I always tell you, take the written word seriously. You don't need somebody to come and tell you the word. But why are all these gifts there? Imagine what I did to that girl. I just went and told her the Logos word, the written word. Now, she could have opened that book and stood on that word all the time. That's why when you come to the maturity of the faith, I told you these gifts may cease. They may not be there for you because you don't need them. You'll flow in them, but you don't need them. So I went and told your husband, go lay hands on him. Okay? And God has said, and he is going to be well. Her husband comes out of that coma or whatever after she did that. But my point is that word was always there in that word. Are you understanding? This is the word of knowledge, okay? Look at Acts 10. Cornelius was given a word of knowledge through a vision and an angel about Simon Peter. So Cornelius is praying. God appears to Simon Peter and says, you know what? You're going to go to Cornelius' house and you're going to speak and his whole household is going to come into the kingdom. And so Cornelius is again told he has a vision where to go and who to call for. Word of knowledge that is given to Cornelius. Now, even as I'm telling you this, you'll start operating in it. You'll start seeing things for your friends. Certain things. Now, word of knowledge is not prophetic. It's something that already exists. So you might know some situations. Are you going through this? Is this thing happening? And why are you there? Not just to make it more big. No, to give comfort, to build edification, to show them the word. That help them remember that they're a son. Are you understanding? Okay, now look at this. In John 4, Jesus has a word of knowledge about the Samaritan woman at the well. Remember, he's sitting at the well. He's tired. He's waiting. The woman comes and she's drawing the water. And then Jesus engages in a conversation and says, go call your husband. And she's like, I have no husband. He's like, you're very right. You have no husband. You've had five husbands and the one that is now is not even your husband. And so this lady is like, oh, he told me everything that I ever did. That means word of knowledge. How does he know certain things about my life that only I know? And what happens because of that word of knowledge? She gets saved and she forgets the pot there because now she's in love with this man that she was looking for all her life, Jesus. And Jesus reveals himself as Messiah to her. Okay? So what are all these gifts for? To draw you to him. To make you realize that you're a son. So we don't pursue the gifts. Are you understanding? We lay them down actually in sonship in this church here. Okay? Now look at this. Look at the gift of the word of faith. Let me read Romans 12:3. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. That means if you can keep watering that faith, and what's going to happen to that faith? It's going to increase. What happened about, now I spoke about the spirit of might last Sunday. Maybe the spirit of might was open to everybody. But it started showing up in the lives to the ones who by faith were engaging with the spirit of might. That's the only difference. How does a one person have a testimony above the other? They just don't forget. They interact. They involve. They apply. And so they get the testimony. Had I seen that tire, and imagine I would have said, oh, but last week nothing happened. I lifted up by an inch. I called the spirit of might last week, but nothing happened. And imagine I would have failed to see me flip the tires. And so what? I went at it again. Let's try again. Spirit of might, come on, you're with me. Now there's a video also. Okay? And engage and you flip it. You flip the tires. But you engage with everything that I'm saying. Apply it because it's true. Okay? So word of faith. Okay? So each one is given a measure of faith. And the one who has it is just exercising it more. So God has given to each one. Look at this. It says, We all have been given a measure of faith, and it starts with faith we have for our salvation, okay, that God only gave it to us, okay? But the gift of faith takes it to a whole other level. It's the kind of faith that shifts things in the natural, and it usually works with other gifts like healing and miracles, okay? The gift of faith. I remember like when my mom had the first report that came as cancerous. The first report showed malignant. Go check again. And I remember that time, that looks like just such a mountain in front of you. Because cancer, mom, my dad, I've already had something like that, can't show up. And so in that time, that entire faith that rose up and says, no, it's I am a son. Psalm 91 is my covenanted relationship, that nothing can touch my loved ones because I'm a son. And that whole urgency and the rest, the labor was not to fight something that is already under my feet. Okay, and so that prayer request and all of that would have just been unbelief, trying to fight something that has already been fought. And so the rest was not praying and not trying to fix something that needs to be fixed. And I told you, even as I rested and we did that same report again, I said, we'll do this again, this test, this is wrong. It came on a Good Friday and it came negative for cancer. But the gift of faith that is given, and it's available to each son. Jesus had it. And so we walk in his faith, not in, you know, your faith towards God. As a son, you begin to rest that it's all his faith. That's why even that tire, it's not me, it's you who is going to lift it. So when the pain came, how can you come? When I didn't lift it, you did. So by what authority are you going to give me pain? And I'm telling you, it was so miraculous. Pain came, like heavy, and then it just left instantly. No pain. I've never felt something so instant. Like in my mind, in my sleep, I was saying, wow, that was instant. Okay, and I was like, resurrection life. And imagine in my sleep, I'm saying these things. Like I don't even remember it. It's because you know what? Who you are is greater than anything that the world is saying. So you'll come to the point, trust me, when you will be so normal about your abnormality. It's very normal to you. What does miracle mean? Okay, we'll talk about that a little later on, okay? So that's the gift of faith, okay? Let's talk about gift of healings. Okay, now not all healings are physical. There's emotional, there's, you know, healing that you can have and God can heal you. I believe, you know, when we look at Benny Hinn's life, you look at A.A. Allen, John G. Lake, all of these guys who did these amazing, and they just flow in a gift. It's available to everybody as a son because Jesus healed everybody who's in their path. He's healing them. But some are just flowing in that and it's given to them. Like Benny Hinn, like I remember I got saved watching a Benny Hinn video on TV. And, you know, it was a program that was played and I saw these people getting healed. At that time I was sick and I got healed watching him. But I didn't stay there because he heals. It's amazing. He's got a gift, but the doctrine is completely old. And so sometimes people think gift, and so even what they're saying should match. Not necessarily, because it's a gift. And here, I told you, as sons, you're waking up. You know the resurrection life in you is doing all of these things. I love it. It's because none of the testimonies are Priya laid hands on me. And they got healed. It's like the resurrection life in me repelled it. That is oneness. You will never hear a testimony about Priya did something. It's you, Christ. You're dead. It's Christ in you who's doing everything. That is sonship. Are you understanding? So we have the gifts, okay? So A.A. Allen, what are the gifts of healing? Where these cancers, just tumors fall off. Okay, cancer supernaturally getting healed. And all of these gifts are there. So imagine now some son comes in a meeting and he gets healed. But he can go back and fall sick again. And so what is better? What is better? To have you wake up to who you are? And then start realizing, because I can lay hands and the sickness will go, and then you might fall sick again because you don't know how to stay healed. And so sonship is what? Once you go around the mountain and take it down, if you stop going around the mountain, you take it down, you're never going around that mountain again. Now what is happening to these sons here? Anything that's showing up, they sleep, because that resurrection life is doing what it's supposed to do. They've gotten out of the way. They know they're dead. Nothing can survive on a dead body. That resurrection life is doing. So now what are you learning to do? You're learning to rest and relax and enjoy your relationship being a son. I told you, you don't believe to make it true. You believe because it is the truth about you. And so now what are you doing? You're resting in that belief that yes, this is who I am, not trying to become. Anyone who's trying to pursue healing is trying to become something. The reason you don't pursue healing is because you already are. It's a difference, and you learn to rest, and that anxiety and all that mess is in your mind, and that's where you're getting dominion into rest. That relax, rest, that resurrection life will do. I was so surprised by the dream I had because it was instantaneous. Do you know that I got up in the morning and wondering, did I have conversations in the night? And I was trying to get like, and who spoke that? Because that wisdom was completely him. How can the pain come when you didn't lift it, I did? That was completely the Father. Okay, no pain. Look at, let's go to, so what am I saying? All of these gifts are there. You will lay hands. If someone comes to you, lay hands on them. If they didn't get healed, lay hands on them again. If they didn't get healed, lay hands on them again. And keep doing that and know that that resurrection life in you is flowing out to fix them, to heal them. But Jesus said, do you know that he did all the healings and everything for one thing? So that you believe. So that you believe. That's why, what is the purpose? Not to be the healer. He says, if you don't believe me because of the works that I do. So why was he doing all the works? To make them believe that he's the Son sent by the Father. So after you come into the kingdom, so I will heal, but I know that there's a better way. That, and it may take some time. So what happened here? Maybe these people had these things. The first they go somewhere else, they want the pastor to pray. But I know that this might take time, but that word is getting rooted and rooted, and we are watering that seed, watering, and now that word is becoming alive. And isn't it a better place? Because now I'm not fixing their problems. Christ is. He's automatically doing it. That is sonship. Okay? So do I operate? Yeah, we operate, but sometimes I lay those gifts down because I want to see a greater work in you and what that word is going to do in you. So allow that word to do what it's supposed to do. Okay? Working of miracles. What is a miracle? What is a miracle? A miracle is anything that defies the laws of gravity, right? Laws of nature. Laws of nature, laws of gravity, laws of anything here in this realm. And so people will look at it and call it a miracle. Like, for example, Jesus walking on water. What was he defying? Maybe the law of gravity or the laws of nature, where if you walk on water, you should just like sink in. Okay? Turning water into wine. The laws of matter. Like, it's supposed to be like this, but how is it turning, changing from one state to another? And so we look at it and call it a miracle. Okay? But I want you to know that in our kingdom, if we are sons, then this is normal to us. For the world, it is a miracle, but to us, it is normal. Flipping a tire, first my mind, oh, this has never happened. So I remove that lie, and now, oh, this is normal. I can flip tires. Maybe I can do it with a finger. Okay? Be open to what God wants to do in your life. So look at this, okay? John 2, Jesus turned water into wine. John 11, Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. Matthew 14, 13, 21, the multiplication of food. What is this? He's got no bread, and so now he says, give me what you have. No lack. Oh, we have 2 loaves and 5 fish. Bring it to me, and in his hand, because the Son lacks nothing. The Son lacks nothing. Only 1-inch tire went up. Yay! Now it gets multiplied. Not just 1 inch. You will do more than 100 inches. Okay? It gets multiplied. Acts 19, Paul performed extraordinary miracles through handkerchiefs and aprons. You know, they used to take, when Paul was preaching, they took handkerchiefs and aprons and they would pray and go and give these cloths to other people and people would get healed. That's the same with you. That's why the lady came and touched Jesus' hem and she got healed, because it's not on the clothes, it's on you. And so everything about you has power. Are you understanding? So people can touch you and they can get healed. As Jesus is, so are you. Don't get offended by that truth. They threw stones at him because he called him equal with God. But so are you, because we are one with him. You're seated in him. How much more equal can you get? Okay? In fact, the minute you humble yourself to receive this truth, you're honoring your Father. And you're valuing the price that he paid to bring you back to this truth, his Son. Okay? It's pride when you don't accept it. Look at this. Look at Acts 15. Then all the multitudes kept silent and listened to Barnabas and Paul declaring how many miracles and wonders God had worked through them among the Gentiles. Acts 11:9. Now God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul. You will do unusual miracles. Be open to that. Conceive it first. Like, what can unusual be to the world? Okay? Hebrews 2:4. God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders and various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit according to his own will. Miracles, miracles. That word miracle in Greek actually means just dunamis, power, might, strength, power, miracle, like power. That's a miracle. Imagine going to the doctor, someone has a tumor, and then you pray for them and the tumor disappears. someone has one kidney and doesn't have two kidneys, you go pray and then two kidneys appear. That's a miracle. That's a miracle, and that's happened. I remember I'd gone with Cyril once and to Dharavi somewhere, and someone, I don't remember, but he had some kidney issue. And that was young. That was the time when I came to know you can lay hands and get people healed. So I was doing all of that. And so I go with Cyril, and so we prayed for somebody who had a kidney or something, some issue like that. And he's not supposed to live. And then 1 year later, Cyril tells me, oh, that guy's like running around and he's all well. And what happened when he went back, that the kidneys started working together. Like nothing is wrong with your kidneys. Both of them appear. Everything is fine. That was really miraculous. And I came to know that one year later. Okay. But like I said, what is the greater thing? What are all these gifts for? To bring the people into the kingdom. And after they come into the kingdom, what is maturity? Start listening to the word and about who you are. So that you don't need these anymore. You're not living your life from miracle to miracle. You're living your life in a state of blessing. Are you understanding? Okay. Prophecy. Okay, let's look at prophecy. Okay, now prophecy, a lot of people, I think, mix word of knowledge and prophecy together. So people can flow in word of knowledge and then begin to prophesy. And that's where the error happens. So there's a difference between this. And I've got hit by this and I've got hurt by this also. Like people have come, you know, they lay hands on me, and this happened many years ago. And people maybe were flowing in the word of knowledge where they could see certain things. But now they begin to speak certain things about the future. And that's where the error happened. And that's where I feel people get hit and hurt. And they feel like, oh, they said some things they saw, but it didn't happen. And I believe that person was just flowing in the word of knowledge, not in the prophetic. Okay. And what is prophecy? Let's look at what the word says. What is the gift of prophecy? In Revelation 19. Then he said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God, and I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, see that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant, and I'm your and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus, worship God. Imagine someone is falling down to John and worshiping him, and he's saying, listen, I am not, don't do that. Okay? Worship God. And now this is prophecy. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. What is the spirit of prophecy? The testimony about Jesus. Do you know that every time you come and testify about something that happened in your life? That's why I say it is an echo. It is a spirit of prophecy to somebody else. And somebody else is going to hear your testimony and step right into it. That's why don't hide your testimonies. Come and share is of what Christ has done in you and through you. It is a prophetic voice. The testimony of Jesus is also everything that you're saying about him. Do you know that when you have some lying symptoms in your body and you're saying, I am the resurrection and the life, do you know that is the testimony of Jesus? And guess what's going to happen? It's the spirit of prophecy. You're prophesying your future already. That, yeah, this lying symptom can't be in me. It's getting repelled. That's what it is. That is the spirit of prophecy. And so one can be operating in the word of knowledge, and I can see certain things in your life, and then maybe I begin to speak certain things, prophetic. And so people mix it. What is prophecy? It's only for edification, for exhortation and comfort. That means to build you up, to exhort, and to give you comfort. I'm not going to tell you anything apart from the word. Someone came to me and said that I have so many properties. What do you think I should do? I said, do you want a prophetic word? You can't lose anything. Now, it's out of the Logos word, I've taken it. But to that person, it's very real because I just said it. You can't lose anything. I've just told them the word of God. That's it. I don't counsel anything else as sons. We don't counsel anything outside the word of God. Everything is in the word of God. Okay. Someone came and said some marriage issues, and I didn't need a prophetic voice to tell me. I said, my dear, God will not do anything apart from his word. So I can look into the word and tell you exactly why this is not happening and why this will happen. I'm not being prophetic. I'm just looking at the word and saying this. I gave a counsel to a couple once, and I said that you've forgotten you're a son. This relationship is going to end in death. How do you know that? I said, I don't. I'm looking in the word, and the word says that you have to be a lion, like speak up for what you believe, not submit to your husband. I said, yeah, it's fine. It's written there, but you don't understand. Your purpose is to draw him in. If you're not opening up, it's not going to end in life. And they both knew Jesus, okay? But one was a son, the other didn't. That relationship didn't pan out. It ended in death. And now she's married to another son, and she's speaking in that relationship and drawing him in. And giving all that life, okay? The word was enough for me to even see how it was going. Okay, so what is prophet? Is this like some light coming and telling me? No, the word is enough. The word is my counsel. Okay? Let's look at discerning of spirits. I'm going to take another 10 minutes and we're going to be done, okay? Discerning of spirits. Okay, now what is discerning of spirits? Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. For many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is 1 John 4:1. Okay? Do not be conformed to this world. I'm reading Romans 12. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Hebrews 5:12. I'm going to read these because they're important, okay? For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Hebrews 4:12. This is very important, guys, so you heard it. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and marrows, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. But test everything, hold fast what is good. Why is discerning of spirits so important? If you don't know the covenants, if you don't know the Old Testament, and when I say covenant, I don't mean testament, because even a lot of the Gospels is still the Old Covenant. Jesus walked in it to fulfill the law. So a lot of things that he's saying is not necessary to you. He's saying it because he was under the law. He had to fulfill the law. That's why, imagine the 3/4 of the New Covenant, like Christ in you, that revelation that you died, it's all Christ in you, was given to someone who didn't hang out with Jesus in the flesh when Jesus was here on the earth. It should have been given to the disciples, right? Like you think, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, they should get it. But God chose Paul, who was not hanging out with Jesus. Why? It's because the disciples saw him in the flesh. They saw him under the law. And so God takes someone who has not hung out with him, takes Paul, and gives him this revelation of sonship that I'm preaching to you today. Okay? So why is discerning of spirits so important? It's because if you don't know the covenants that you died, it's all Christ, that all of the Old Testament has been fulfilled in Mary till that seed came, and after that seed has come, now it's all Christ. Now you're a son just like him. The first born again, Jesus is, but of many brethren, there are many other sons. Are you understanding? So why is this truth so important? Because any dream that comes in, someone can walk up to you and say, thus says the Lord, and you will discern. People miss it. It's because they don't know the covenants. They don't know it's a finished work. And so they say, thus saith God. We had somebody elder in our church, Gitu, she got a call from somebody whose husband was serious in the hospital with COVID. And this, her wife, and so their sort of group believes in casting out things and deliverance and things, and it's pretty much all of the Old Testament. And so when she gets a dream, the wife's friend gets a dream and says, don't go and lay hands on him because God doesn't want him to live, or something like that, okay? And some dream that they interpreted, Gitu had reached out to them and said, your son, it's in God's perfect will for this man to live. Okay, but imagine a dream, and then, do you know when then Gitu even tried to speak to this person, she took up some chapters from the Old Testament and says, look at this, look at this, look at this, and quoted some scriptures from the Old. And you know what happened at the end? The husband passed away. And in my head, I'm thinking, all of this, if you don't know who you are, you can't even discern. Because the devil is showing you some scripture, and that person has got blinded by scripture on this side of the Bible. What did the devil do to the Jesus on the mount when he was being tempted? He quoted scripture. But Jesus is wise and he knew. He doesn't need to jump. He can even fly, That was stupid of him to quote Psalm 91. Okay, he's the son of man. Nothing can happen to him. But my point is, if you don't know, you can't even discern. Discerning of spirits. And so I told Gitu, and Gitu told her, I don't care what dream you got. The word is enough. Jesus healed everybody, and if the husband is, go lay hands on him and raise him up, because it's God's perfect will to heal him. Okay? I had once when I was in church, and I had this dream beforehand, okay? And this was in my early years, and there was this prophet who came into that church and started pulling up people in the church and started just telling them all their sins. You do this, you do this, you do this, this is wrong, you're watching this. And all of these people were very excited about this thing. But now in Hebrews, it says that your sins I will remember no more. So if God doesn't remember my sins, who is this person coming and pulling out all their sins? What spirit is that? And then everyone thinks this is the Holy Spirit. Okay, now this was my early years, okay? So I'm looking at this going on, and I had a dream that night. And someone comes in my dreams and tells me, what is the difference between this lady and a fortune teller? A fortune teller, that means it's just, you know, by wrong spirit, okay? So the next day I go, I don't even know this prophet is supposed to come. I see all of these things going on. Now I go in the evening for a Bible study, and this lady has come there. Now I've got my head down. And suddenly like a thought comes, and not a good thought. And do you know that when those thoughts are not of yours, like you just know it. So in my head, I'm like, I didn't think this. Father, you know this is not my thought, okay? Like I thought something really bad. And suddenly this lady says, get your thoughts on God, daughter. And the minute she said that, I was like, this spirit is wrong. Because I knew that this is not mine. The Father knows this is not mine. Who told her this? The one who put it. Are you seeing it? Discerning of spirits. And so I was like, I don't care what she pulled, this is not God. And I walked out, and imagine the whole church was gaga over this person because they're pulling out sins. Stick to the word. So now I told you the word is a discerner between spirit and soul. So if you don't know the finished work, you will get carried away by the bandwagon, and 100 people are doing it, and you get sucked into that 100 also. That's why you have to know the finished work of the Christ. Which side of the cross are you on? Not on this side. We're on the resurrected side of the cross, where everything is finished. So if he doesn't see any sins about me and everything is under the blood, who are you to pull out something? Okay? Who are you remembering it? Because clearly he doesn't. Okay? And we honor the Father. So discerning of spirits, okay? So it's so important, that's why, to lay the foundation of the finished work. Because then automatically you'll start discerning what is, what is not. I've had people, I told you, prophesy things about my life, and I really believe, you know, when even we talk about prophecy, like Jesus prophesied about Jesus. Jesus prophesied about Peter, like the kind of death he was going to have. Okay? Peter already knew it. I don't believe that the Father will tell you anything new. That's your relationship that you get to have with him. So whatever is already in your heart, he might just affirm it through somebody else. But I don't think it'll be like a fresh thing that you hear and that you didn't know anything about. Because I believe that creates separation between a relationship. If some third party came and told you something. I told you my rest, right? Once when this everyone was running to this prophet because he's going to tell you things about your life. And in my head, I just come into the kingdom. I was like, what is he going to tell me? I don't already know. He better not. Because is my father keeping something from me? That's the first thing that happened to me. Okay? So, sons, you rest in your absolute relationship that you know all things. You know the Father and the Father knows you. Okay? That's the confession of your mouth. Different kinds of tongues and interpretation of tongues. Okay, now you read Corinthians 14, okay, where it talks about, I'm just going to read from, why do you all pray in tongues? New people here, okay? I'm going to read from, I'm going to read on Romans 8:26. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called for his purpose, according to his purpose. What are you doing when you're praying in tongues? When you're praying in tongues, it says you're praying the perfect will of God. I told you once my mom had a lump here, early years, okay, and I didn't know what that lump was. I just saw her face, I woke up, I began to pray in tongues, I spoke Psalm 91, I went to sleep. The next day, her best friend comes and says, Sarojini, what is this lump here? And my mom hates doctors. But because her best friend said she went to the doctor, the doctor said, very good, you've come now, this was TB, but you've come exactly at the right time so medication can fix this. And so God knew it, and so when I'm praying in tongues, I'm praying without my understanding. But Jesus is praying the perfect prayer about that situation, and the matter got fixed. That's what is happening when you're praying in tongues. Okay? And so what does it say? Look at in verse 13, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 13. Okay? For if I pray in a tongue, my spirit prays, but my understanding is unfruitful. What is the conclusion there? I will pray with the spirit, I will also pray with understanding. I will sing with the spirit, I will also sing with understanding. That means pray in your understanding. But also, try and be conscious that every time you're praying in tongues. Because it's the Spirit praying about that situation. Sometimes the Spirit is only praying, Priya, get out of the way. Priya, get out of the way. Relax. Learn to relax. Cast this care. And then Priya is learning to rest even as you're praying in tongues. Okay? Paul said that, you know, I pray in tongues more than you all. So I encourage you to pray in tongues. What is interpretation of tongues? Okay? I think by faith you should start doing this here in Beloved. Okay? When we're praying in tongues, when we're coming on Sunday, it says that when you're praying in tongues, let somebody by faith begin to interpret that tongue. So just begin when we're coming together and praying, open your mouth and maybe the Holy Spirit will fill it about what God is saying or what the Spirit is saying in that situation. Okay? And that is the interpretation of tongues. I put those scriptures there so you can read it. And why are all of these gifts here? Why is the interpretation of tongues there? Why is all of these things here? It says that so that when an uninformed or an unbeliever comes in, he will come into the kingdom. He'll see that God is so real in our midst. And he'll get saved and he'll come into the kingdom. That's it. But so why are all of these gifts there? I told you, why are all of these gifts here? To build you up, to edify you. But we don't get stuck in them. You can heal people and you can get stuck in the identity of a healer. You can prophesy and do all these prophetic things and get stuck in the identity of a prophet. Okay? Look at this. 1 Corinthians 12. I'm going to end this in this. For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. For in fact the body is not one member, but many. The body is not one member, but many. If the foot should say, but I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? That means my foot will say I'm not of the body. Is it important to me? Can I feel it? When you bang your foot, can your whole body feel it? Suppose Zara comes and touches somebody here. Can your whole body feel it? Your whole body will feel it. That's why in Revelation also, in oneness, if you get it and start walking as sons, the whole body will get it. That's when you hear Priya. They're speaking the same thing. They're preaching the same thing. They're also talking about oneness. They're also talking about sonship. Yeah, because you started waking up. The whole body will get it. Okay? Now see this. But now indeed, okay, because I am not a hand, am I not the body? Is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? That means if one person is doing everything, who is the eye? Who is the foot? Who is the hand? Okay? Okay? Who would do the hearing? If the whole body were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them in the body, just as he pleased. And if they were all one member, where would the body be? That means little finger. That means I can do everything. I don't need Za. I don't need Gitu. I don't need Hebron. I don't need Sheetal. God has purposely displaced everything because you need everybody. Okay? And because in everyone we're going to see it. Together. Are you understanding? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, much rather those members of the body which seem to be weaker are necessary, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on these we bestow greater honor, and our unpresentable parts have greater modesty. But our presentable parts have no need. But God composed the body, having given greater honor to that part which lacks it, that there should be no cynicism. How do you pronounce that? Schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care for one another. And if one member suffers, all the members suffer with it. And if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are of the body of Christ and members individually, and God has appointed these in the church, and that's what you're doing. First apostles, second prophets, third teachers, and after that miracles, the gifts of healing, helps, administrations, varieties of tongues, are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles, do all have the gifts of healing, do all speak with tongues, do all interpret, but earnestly desire the best gifts. And yet I show you a much excellent way. And then Paul goes on to talk about just walking in love. Okay, and he talks about, take on prophecy out of all, because, you know, prophecy will edify and build out of all. But he talks about, look at this in verse 13, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I should remove mountains, but I have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. Is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Does not rejoice in iniquity. That means in sin. But rejoices in the truth. Bears all things. Believes all things. Hopes all things. Endures all things. Love never fails. But whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect has come, what is perfect? But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. Remember, we spoke about all these gifts are there so that you become into the perfection of the Son of God, to the mind of Christ. And so it's saying here, when that which is perfect has come, that which is in part will be done away. That means these gifts will cease. Okay, when I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, it's all there to help you when they're babies. Yeah, come on, I'm laying, my gift is here to heal you, to set you free, to prophesy, to do all of these things, okay? But it's saying here, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I am. I also am known. Are you understanding? These are all gifts they will seize till you're coming to the maturity of a son. That's why fivefold ministry will seize. Sonship is here. I rather wake you up into who you are. That resurrection life is kicking out things out of people. What is better? What is better? And so what do I do? I lay that gift down. I may have the gift, but I lay it down. I use it to bring to bring unbelievers in. So I use mostly, I lay hands on people who are sick, who are unbelievers. And then the minute I get them into the kingdom, I start pushing sonship. And then it might take time. Because if I lay, it's quick. But then they also come back to me quickly with another problem. And then if I lay that foundation down of sonship, it takes time, but it is permanent. That foundation. And you've made them a matured son now. Are you understanding? And see this. And now abide faith, hope, and love. These three. But the greatest of these is love. And so hear that sermon on love in spirit and in truth. If you hear that sermon, you'll realize we actually in Beloved love you a lot. To pierce that word into you and not do the things sometimes that the churches do. But here we don't, and it looks cold. Like, oh, she's a little cold. She doesn't do this, she doesn't do that. Okay, but I do it because I love you. And love. His love looks a bit different because I have to love you in spirit and in truth. Okay? And me reminding you so that you don't forget who you are. You've come to me with this problem. Listen, who has come to me with this problem? Christ came to me with this problem. And then you'll realize, oh, why did I come to her? Are you understanding? We love each other in spirit and in truth, not with the worldly love. Oh, what happened? How was your day? You look tired. You'll never hear me say that to you. Okay? Because you're a son. Okay, so just a recap, we spoke about this, the seven spirits, engage with them. The spirit of might is what I'm engaging in recently. And the gifts of the spirit, there are nine gifts of the spirit. Okay, and all of these gifts are there. You're using them at some point, you'll see certain things for others and for things to bring them up to the maturity of the son. And next week we're going to talk about the fruits of the spirit, love, joy, peace, patience. All of these fruits are also living beings. They're not just a fruit hanging on a tree in the kingdom. It's a living being, and you can have joy and engage with joy. Joy, thank you. Today I was low in the morning, and I was waking up, and I was like, the sun has no low. I don't know what that term is. And I said, I went to one of the verses, just came alive in me, and I started speaking it, and I realized that the kingdom is so alive. Okay? It's because, you know, when you're matured, God expects you to walk in that maturity. He's like, you know better. You know better. I've already taught you more. You can't be doing this what others are doing. Are you understanding that? So you walk in that truth. Okay, so engage in the kingdom. Just don't be hearers of the word. Be doers of the word. Apply it, and so you're going to see this kingdom so alive. Okay, so let's get up today and give a spiritual tithe of all the increase that you got. Okay, so say this after me. Father, I thank you, I'm a son in your kingdom. Jesus, you are my high priest. And right now, I give you a tithe of all the increase that you brought to my soul. And begin to worship him with it. Oh, Rahadaranama. Thank him for all this understanding that came to you today. For all the increase. Just say this, Father, your resurrection life in me is giving life to this mortal body. Yeah, everything in me is alive. Amen. Amen. Okay, so stay back, all sons. We are celebrating Geeta.